So, okay, CUDA. CUDA stands for Compute Unified Device Architecture, which makes pretty much no sense. The important thing to know about CUDA is it's something called a SIMD architecture. SIMD means single instruction, multiple data. And we will talk about that in detail. But basically what it is you have some number of processors, it's called an N, doesn't matter how many, but every processor executes the exact same instruction at the exact same time. On a multi-core machine or on a cluster, you know, you have standard CPUs and they can be doing things a little bit out of step and one might lag behind another because of I/O or the operating system was angry at somebody or whatever the reason was. But in a GPU and in a SIMD architecture, it's lockstep. Every processor does this. Turn the crank, every processor does the next thing. And that's important. We're going to talk about that. And that one piece of architecture allows us to have thousands of concurrent threads. Why? Because every thread doesn't need its own state. There's only one state for all the threads, so we don't have to keep like a process control block for every single thread. We don't need to know what their registers are. We don't need to know where in the code they are, the stack pointer, all that stuff, gone. And not totally gone. We need some of it, right? But we only need to keep one copy for all the threads, and we can do that in hardware very easily. So that's what leads us to the hardware support. Now we can stick these things in hardware, and when we need to context switch because we're waiting on a memory request, or the threads are finished, we can do that extremely fast. It's basically a free operation to swap one thread out for another. And that's the reason that we can get thousands of concurrent threads, because they put all that into hardware. Another important thing about CUDA and GPUs in general is all these cores that I'm talking about, and I said this was different apples to oranges, they're somewhat reduced functionality. It's not the same as a Core i7. It does the same kind of math, but a Core i7 or your AMD chips, they have all sorts of crazy instructions that, you know, solve PDEs in one instruction, or you know, they can do their assembly level instructions are much more complicated. They take different amounts of time. In a GPU, you have simple RISC style instructions that all take about the same amount of time and aren't that complicated. So there's definitely a reduction in functionality. Also, in a core, a core is somewhat of a nebulous term. On a GPU, a core kind of means a floating point unit, but there's other things on the processor that do math and other operations that aren't part of the floating point unit. For example, there's sometimes you implement transcendental functions and various sines and cosines in hardware. Other types of math expansions get put in hardware. And that's true in CPUs too, but on a GPU, there's not a one-to-one relationship with floating point units and special function units. So if you're running code and you're doing some kind of weird math, you may serialize, even though you have 100 cores or 128 cores, you may only have 24 special function units. So you have to be aware of what's going on and why isn't this 128 times faster? Well, you're kind of serializing behind the use of that real estate. That's a good double precision is a good example of that. Typically on a GPU a lot, or before the new stuff came out, I'm not sure about the new stuff, but maybe 3 months ago, there were single point units and single precision and double precision units, and there's more single precision than double precision. So if you're using double precision, you take a hit in performance. So these are just some of the things you need to know about the architecture. But the single most important thing is this single instruction, multiple data. All the cores are doing the same thing at the same time. And lastly, this stuff changes like every 6 months. This week is NVIDIA's GTC, their big yearly conference where they announce all their new stuff, and they just announced a whole bunch of new stuff. Their newest GPUs came out like 3 months ago that have a new programming paradigm that allows you to do things you could never do before. So, I mean, you know, every 3 to 6 months there's new stuff. So I don't want to say take it with a grain of salt, but a lot of this will change in a year, and if I were to give this talk a year from now, I'd be saying different things. Here's a quick picture of what a portion of the GPU looks like. So you have a whole bunch of cores, and you can see those cores. And then you have some number of special function units on the right that do various things. So that's, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. You have 32 cores and 4 special function units. So if everyone needs special function units, you gotta wait. You also have a shared register file. You have some shared caches. Texture units are shared. So there are things that are shared. And if you have to use these a lot, then you're going to see reductions in performance. This picture shows something called an SM, which is a streaming multiprocessor. And all the cores are aggregated into various SMs. And depending on your GPU and your model and how much you paid for it, you'll have more SMs than somebody else. And SMs are kind of like the processor. Your cores are kind of like your floating point units that can do the bulk of the math, but the SM is kind of similar to, I don't want to say it's similar to a CPU, but it's kind of the limiting factor. So the more SMs you have, the better. And as I said, you can see a bunch of the stuff is shared across from all the cores across a single SM. So there's a specific amount of cores per SM, and there's a specific amount of SMs per GPU, depending upon the model you have. And NVIDIA and AMD have hundreds of different models, so almost every card is going to be different, unless it's like the exact same number. And the way that they architect the programming interface, it abstracts all this stuff away. So you don't need to worry about this when you're actually writing your code, but when you're looking at performance, you do. So we have 32 cores in this single SM. Let's say our SM has, I don't know, we have 16 SMs. So we have, you know, 2 to the 4th times 2 to the 5th, 2 to the 9th cores. That's a lot, right? So how do we organize all that stuff? Well, what CUDA does, and this is pretty CUDA specific, is we group all these things into threads, thread blocks, and a grid. So a single thread is an individual piece of execution that runs on a single core. So when you turn that crank, it's one of those cores is executing an add instruction, a multiply, a divide, that's a thread. Threads are logically grouped into warps, what are called warps, and that's called warps from previous incarnations of parallel processing. And that matters a little bit for performance. A warp is 32 threads. You don't really have to worry about this when you're writing code, but when you're doing your analyzation of your programs, you do. So now you have, you know, let's say you have your program and you want to launch a bunch of threads. Well, you group them into something called thread blocks. And typically, you put 128 threads or 256 threads or some power of 2 into a thread block, and then you create however many thread blocks you need to cover your data space. And that however many thread blocks you need is called a grid. When you run these things on the GPU, what you're running is called a kernel. So there's lots of different names for, you know, work unit or work sharing, or all in CUDA land it's called a kernel. And another interesting thing in lots of other parallel processing, like OpenMP, if you're familiar with OpenMP, or other areas where you might have a semaphore between two competing threads of execution, you can't do that in CUDA. You really cannot communicate across threads. There are some ways, but that's only for data reuse and not typically for logic. So you can't really implement parallelism where you need things like semaphores. So just keep that in mind. So we have threads, we have thread blocks. What does this all look like? Well, if we have some thing we want to do on the GPU, some kernel, we create some number of thread blocks, and each thread block has some number of threads in it. So in the top case, we have 6 thread blocks, and each thread block has 15 threads. So for a total of 90 threads, I think, we're launching in that top case. And then these numbers are small. Typically, you're going to launch 30,000 threads with 1,000 thread blocks or some really big number. There are limitations. So it, depending on your GPU and the version and all that stuff, you may, there's only a certain amount of threads you can have, there's only a certain amount of thread blocks you can have. Typically, you don't run into those issues, but they are there. So here's just kind of a picture. You have all these cores, but the cores are grouped into SMs, and the SMs are individual units. So when I say one, we turn the crank and all the threads are doing the same exact thing, that's all the threads on an SM. The other SMs may be doing other stuff. And that's okay, because threads on one SM cannot in any way communicate with threads on another SM. Actually, it's even more strict than that. Even if there's two thread blocks kind of swapping in and out on a single SM, those two thread blocks can't communicate, even though they're on the same SM. So here's a quick example. Let's say we have two lists of numbers, two vectors, and we want to add them together and put the result in a third vector. Pretty easy, right? So in a typical CPU environment, we just write a for loop, and we put that line in the body of the for loop. But in CUDA, what we do is we define a kernel, which you can see via the global tag, and it takes parameters. It takes three arrays, two input arrays A and B, and the output array C. Now, the cool thing about CUDA is that every thread knows what thread it is. So you have all these threads, but how does one thread know what to do versus another thread? So every thread has an ID, and that's how we determine what the threads do. So thread 0 is going to read, okay, we're going to set, this is how you figure out what the thread ID is, and we just create that index, and we say, yeah, so I'm thread 0, I'm going to load from A0 and B0 and put the sum in C0. Thread 1 is going to load from A1 and B1 and put the sum in C1. It's pretty simple. But, like I said, what if you have a million elements? Well, you can't have a million threads, especially not at the same time. So this is where the thread block ID comes in. We group threads into blocks. So every block has 256 threads. So if you're in the third block, if you're the first thread in the third block, there's 512 threads before you. So your ID is 513 or 512 in the zero-based tag. So if we have a lot of threads, to calculate our index, we need to take into account what blocking we are. So every thread knows what thread ID it is, and every thread knows what block it's in. And from those two pieces of information, it can create its unique monotonically increasing index. And from that index, we decide what data it's going to load, what data it's going to operate on. All the threads are going to do the same thing, but they're going to operate on different data. So thread 1 is going to load from a memory location that's different from thread 2. But they're going to do the same thing on the data they just loaded. And that is kind of CUDA in a nutshell. That's basically what we come down to. There's a lot more stuff we can do, but that's how we differentiate threads. That's how we tell them what to do, what not to do. And you can have loops in here that say things like, if my ID is thread 0, and then you only have one thread do something out of your whole thread block. But sometimes maybe if you're doing something at the end and you're doing that reduction, maybe it's only the last thread that you want to sum up the other things, or something like that. So you can do stuff like that, but that is kind of it in a nutshell. You also have this example, those were just vectors, one-dimensional data. What if most data is two or three or n-dimensional? What do we do about that case? Well, think about an image, it's two-dimensional, and if it's a two-dimensional array, you might want to map your threads on it in a two-dimensional form. So instead of just having an ID in the x direction, we can give threads an ID in the y direction. So here's another picture of that. So now we have threads that go across and threads that go down in a single block. So for an example, when we're dealing with a two-dimensional matrix, what column we're in, and J is what row we're in, So we take what block of threads we're in. We say, how wide are those blocks? So if I'm in the fourth block and every block is 256, I'm 4 times 256 plus my individual thread ID. That's how far I am in the x direction. And we do the same for y, so how far I am down in the y direction. And then we get some unique index, or in this case, it's a pair of unique indices. And that can uniquely identify some piece of data in a two-dimensional array. We can extend this to three dimensions with threads if we want to, but it doesn't go past that. So you could have these could be Z's as well. So all this is a way to easily map your threads onto your data. You can do everything as one dimension. It makes no difference at all to the CUDA stuff. It just makes the programming a bit easier to do the mapping of indices. Notice this N here. Sometimes we'll calculate a thread, and there may be more threads than there is data. So in that case, what do? We need to make sure that some threads don't do anything, because we don't want those threads to read stuff that doesn't exist. So that's a typical kind of check you would have. So that was pretty quick on the types of, a lot of code looks like this. You calculate some index, and then you do something with the data you find in that index. And sometimes you'll have a for loop or whatever in there, but don't remember that every thread executes this code. So this isn't one thread, all the threads do this. So that's kind of the tricky thing, or at least the learning curve kind of thing. Does anyone have any questions on that before I move on?
So I'm just a little bit confused because you said that different symmetric multi processors, so different SMs can execute different instructions, right?
Yes.
So like what the code that is out there now, would that run on a single SM or would that?
So when you launch your kernel, when you decide to go, you configure these kernel independent, for the most part, parameters that say how many blocks, thread blocks do I want and how big are those thread blocks. And then the card, the GPU does the management of how many thread blocks you have, and it does all the scheduling and says, oh, you only want this many thread blocks, I have this many SMs, I'm going to distribute those thread blocks and those SMs as I see fit. So for example, let's say you have 5 SMs and 200 thread blocks. So you could just divide evenly, and I can't do, I guess that's 40, right? 40 thread blocks per SM. Well, it's not quite that simple because thread blocks do have some state associated with them, and they don't all fit on an SM at any given time. So you might put one on, it starts doing its stuff, but another one hasn't started going yet. That's why I said they're not exactly doing the same thing at each time. There's also a pretty important thing that has to do that I'm going to talk about with memory. So when you access memory, basically going to memory is super expensive. So all the threads in a thread block want something from memory. Well, it's going to take a long time for all those requests to happen. So the scheduler says, okay, you guys are done. I'm going to wait until your stuff comes back, and I'm going to put some new people on. And that's how they get out of sync.
So when you define like your block, like how many blocks, and you define the dimensions of your blocks?
Yep.
So do you generally set that up to fit your data nicely, or do you set it up to fit the GPU you're going to be working on nicely, or?
Yes. so you usually set up your thread organization, like how you do your indices, based on your data. So if you have like three-dimensional data, it's nice to be able to have three-dimensional indices. However, when it comes down to performance optimizations, there are certain things like you don't really want more than this many blocks, or if you have a very low arithmetically intense kernel, so mostly what you're doing is reading and writing from memory, you might want to have threads do more work. So maybe they don't process one, they process two, and we'll talk about that a little later. So there are issues like that, and it's not, there's no magic way to decide. You can set this up in runtime so you can write your kernels in a completely thread agnostic kind of way. But a lot of times you leave a little bit of performance on the table if you do that. And then when you launch your kernel and you see how much data you have, you can configure it then.
Okay.
So it
is possible though to be somewhat dynamic in the you don't know what GPU your code might be running
yes.
on, you don't know exactly what your input data is going to look like.
Right.
And yeah, maybe it's not perfectly optimized, but you can still, you can write generalized code that handles any data and runs on any old GPU.
Yeah, I should have mentioned that. So like most, all these kernels will run on any GPU, and to do the optimization of how many blocks and how many threads and all that stuff, you can, on the host code, when you start your program, you can query your system for what GPUs you have, and you can say, oh yeah, I have this GPU, it has this many blocks, let's do this.
Right. So you can like add some optimizations
yeah.
on top of it?
Yeah.
Okay.
But there's still stuff that I won't talk about today, like occupancy and how full things are that are more GPU specific, and when you end up really optimizing as much as you can, those things end up in the code, unfortunately.
Right.
It's just the way it is. Is that okay?
Good.